citizen.
Out of many we are world citizens. Same vision is for equal rights and justice for the people them. What's happening to this beautiful world that we're living in? World citizen, lift up your voices.
Welcome everyone. Welcome to another episode of the People Powered Planet podcast. Now today, I'm actually coming to you from a conference room in Minnesota rather than our normal backdrop because this afternoon we are having a memorial service on what would have been my wife's dad's 100th birthday. He actually died at age 99, but due to COVID, we couldn't have a memorial service. So finally now we can have a service, and we picked as a date his 100th birthday. So today we're going to be celebrating that remarkable life and remarkable family. And so that's why I'm here in a conference room, and the only decoration I had was one of our shirts. So you get to see the whole shirt this time, just rather than just the top that you usually see me wearing. Anyway, each week on the People Powered Planet podcast, we have remarkable guests, guests who are focusing on solutions. We call them solutionaries because, you know, you can just drown in the depth of podcasts about all the problems and terrible things the world's facing. But what we really need to inspire us to move forward is a vision for a better way and a way that we can practically actually do it. And that's why Gary Davis, the subject of our film, The World is My Country, inspired us to begin to create a people-powered planet podcast, people-powered planet. And this podcast each week explores how do we do that. Now today, we have a very special guest. We have Nathaniel Mills, who's also known as Coach Nat. And you know, he was a skater in three Olympic Games. And he was the team captain of the 1968 US team in Nagano, Japan. And he co-founded the Olympic Project to advance the ideals and practices of the Olympism. Now, Coach Nat actually have a personal connection here. He's the co-founder and head coach of the DC Inner City Excellence, which is called, stands for, it's DC ICE, Inner City Excellence, spells ICE. And it's a skating program that helps inner city youth and empowers them with sports to rise above the challenges they face and to inspire their lives. Now, I know this works, and you know why? Because my own grandson got to meet him and got to observe some of his games. And my grandson at that age had never skated, but he was so inspired by seeing what these big kids could do that he wanted me to get him a pair of skates, and he went out there and skated. And the very first time we started with roller skates, the very first time he got on them, he just was like, zoom, you know, and it went all around. I think you were there at that time, right?
I remember.
And yeah, and you know, I was like blown away. I mean, he'd never been on skates before, and to me, I'd be wobbling. He was just going right forward. He was a natural. Well, he actually sent me a text before this. He wished he could be in on this. He said it was really cool to see what the bigger kids could do. And it was very good that Coach Nat paid attention to me and helped me have a positive early experience of skating. So that inspired him. Now, he is now in the Capitals Hockey Academy. A few years ago when he was even younger, I got to watch him on television because between the Washington Caps games they would have the mini mites get out on the ice, and I watched him score a goal on TV, and then they'd come back with the team. Let's see, that Washington Capitals Academy, can you tell briefly people what the significance of that is, Nat?
That's an elite youth hockey program, and DC Ice, where a lot of kids get their start skating, that's all it's designed to do, is to give them a great experience, give them fundamentals, teach them the Olympic values, and then where they go from there is a matter of their will, their natural talent, and always the family support as well. So the fact that he was able to start, I saw him as a complete rookie, and then to be going on and playing in the Capitals Academy, that I'd never heard that until you just said it. That's a very inspiring story. We've had some kids that go on to the Olympics as well. We have a young lady who's on the Olympic speed skating team, Mame Baini, born in Ghana, grew up near the DC area, and she qualified for her first Olympic team last year, or last Olympics. But we were never trying to, you know, have her become an Olympic athlete. That's not the goal. It's to teach the Olympic values, teach a love of the sport, and then try to become an Olympian in life, which anyone can really do by that lives the Olympic values. But she just happened to have such a strong will that she went on and is one of the top speed skaters in the United States.
Wow, that's pretty cool. Well, now, what are those Olympic values? What was the whole purpose in founding the Olympics?
Great question, and a significant question, because today, if you were aware or not, today is actually Worldwide Olympic Day, June 23rd every year, which is the date that commemorates the birth of Pierre de Coubertin, who was a Frenchman who, along with many people in Greece and others in Europe, helped revive the Olympic Games, which had been dormant for a long time. But he revived the ancient games, and in 1896, the modern Olympics began in Athens, and they've more or less happened every 4 years since. They don't have the same track record that the ancient games had. The ancient games happened every 4 years, uninterrupted for 1,000 years, despite warring. Nearly 1,000 years. And that was despite, you know, warring city states and whatever was going on in the ancient world. The modern games have been derailed due to the world wars. But the Olympic values that de Coubertin wrote down in the Olympic Charter form the philosophy of Olympism. And I can recite them to you off the top of my tongue because I just came from coaching this morning where we had a little Olympic Day event. And every day we try to, you know, nurture these values in our skaters. But finding joy and effort is the big one. Perseverance, unity, friendship, fair play, sportsmanship, service, fun, and of course, excellence. And if you can, I often put fun first, because if something's not fun, it's hard to get to that level where you truly master it. You got to make the hard training fun, make the games fun, make competition fun. At the end of the day, it's really, you know, you're just trying to master yourself, your own body and your own mind. And that should be a fun process. And I'm sure Kai had fun that when he came, even though everyone else was a better skater. And that's all you got to do to spark something.
He had fantastic fun, and I've been so proud of him. And he also follows in your footsteps in other ways too, because in addition to he actually did a project in school called the Blue Dot, and they actually were had time to do something on dots. And he did a little talk about this blue dot that we all live on. And he's actually in our movie, in the long version of The World Is My Country. You see him at the end say, "My country is the whole world." So anyway, that's great.
We're all born. We're all born world citizens. So he's fortunate he has you know grandparents like you to help him remember it, because humans tend to forget that. It gets conditioned out of us through a variety of ways. But it sounds like he's still in touch with that.
You know, I think the cool thing about the Olympics is that people like that sense of, you know, competition, and but instead of competing in wars where we're blowing people up, compete in sports. You know, our team's going to be the best, and our team's going to be the best. Well, you know, that competition, and there's also a lot of cooperation, I think, too, helping others as well. But that's a much better place to be competing than on the battlefield, don't you think?
It is, although, and again, when I was a competing Olympic athlete, I had no idea what any of this meant, what Olympism meant, what those values. I couldn't have told you anything about the bigger picture. I've discovered that since retiring, partially through my journey as a world citizen, but most people don't realize that even though often the Olympic Games can seem like war and political ideology contests, you know, war by other means, and sometimes it even spills over into hostility, but the Olympic Charter itself, actually, Chapter 1 says the Olympic Games are competitions between athletes in individual and team events, and not competitions between countries, which is very interesting when you consider how we consume the Olympics when we watch it. And, you know, we tend to watch the games from, you know, it's televised by our national broadcaster, no matter what nation you're in. And of course, those national broadcasters have national sponsors, and they tend to focus on, well, how many medals is my country winning? Or in case of the United States, are we winning the medal count? Even though the Olympic Charter expressly forbids national medal counting. So there's a I've learned of a disconnect between the first principles of Olympism and the modern day practice of the Olympic Games, just like no different than, you know, looking at the Declaration of Independence or the U.S. Constitution and this wonderful language and ideology that in practice, it's not always what it was envisioned. Yet, just like the history of the United States, you can transcend some of the shortcomings that are in people's minds. And sport, in particular, like art, they're universal activities, so they're a great place to do this. But ultimately, it does take some action and activism to really force things to change.
Well, now, speaking of that, of activism, Coach Nat is a particularly amazing person, because not only are you an Olympic coach, you're also a lawyer. And not only are you a lawyer, but you were very active in WSA's, the World Service Authority that Gary founded, and you knew Gary well. You were part of their legal team that's helping protect human rights around the world. So let's shift gears a little bit and tell us about how that fit in with your journey. Here you are, a sports figure. How did you put that together with law, and how did you end up the coordinator? You're the coordinator of the World Service Authority Sports Commission and of working in their legal department. Tell us a little bit about that.
It was a similar journey, actually, to my athletic journey. I retired from Olympic competition and didn't really know what I wanted to do. And I'd short-shrifted my education because I was so focused on sport. But I ended up applying to and being accepted to law school. And I came out of law school and something wasn't, I just kind of naturally cared about justice and social justice. And there's something in my law school experience that just the law wasn't quite getting at solutions, and international law especially. And I happened to meet Gary Davis not long after that, and I learned about the World Service Authority, I learned about the World Passport and the idea of world law as opposed to international law, that is what it would ultimately take. And so I spent a couple of years working in the legal department representing world citizens that were asserting their human rights, often the right to travel, but often just, you know, needing to assert their identity and not having any way to do so because of their circumstances within the nation state that they were living in, or the nation state that either used to consider them a citizen or was persecuting them. So it became real for me. And that was very rewarding work. And then the marriage of the sports and the law background was the World Sports Commission. Gary asked me to serve as that commission head, and I did. And that work is still ongoing. I think that the biggest vision might be to have a World Olympic team. So these would be athletes that are participating in the games, not representing any nation state. They're there representing humanity. And as you may be able to predict, the International Olympic Committee is, of course, it's international. It's not set up for that in the same way that the United Nations is not set up for global solutions in important ways, whether it's, you know, nuclear weapons or the economy or the environment. And so, that would push things. Now, Arthur, you actually sent me a press release about the Olympic peace movement and the Olympic truce that used to happen. And it reminded me of something that just has been happening in the last 4 years, and that's the Olympic refugee team. In Rio 4 years ago, they had a delegation of refugees. So these were athletes that were at the high level of their sport, but didn't have necessarily a nation state to represent them, because you can't participate unless you have a National Olympic Committee enrolling you. So there's people that fall between the cracks there. And they competed in Rio. I don't believe they won any medals, but they marched in the opening ceremony behind the Olympic flag. And of course, if they had won a medal, a gold medal, the Olympic flag would have been raised instead of a national flag. And I'm waiting for that to happen, because I think the symbolism of that is very powerful and a reminder to people that even though as national subjects, viewers can go nuts and crazy, and there's nothing wrong with rooting for people that you identify with that are from your nation state, but it's supposed to be a movement about humanism. And I think symbolism is obviously important, that Olympic flag is the most recognized flag on earth by ways. So if we can get to that with the help of the World Sports Commission, that would be great. There's one thing for athletes that are just happen to be refugees, but they're trying to become national citizens somewhere. It's another to have athletes who philosophically or for their conscience say, you know what, I don't want to represent a nation state. I'm the best in my sport. I want to compete against the best humans in the world. Let me compete under the Olympic flag. I think it's a win for the Olympic Committee, but you know, we're conditioned to think. I survey people in the Olympic movement, athletes and officials, and the responses are fall into three categories. That's a terrible idea. The Olympics is about national superiority, or that's a great idea, but it'll never happen just because, you know, nationalism conditioning is so strong. Or I never thought about that. That's possible. How do we do that? And the example of how you do that is actually in the 1956 Olympics. Everyone knows the opening ceremony, right? All the national flags come and the national delegation follows the national flag. And then there's the competitions. The winner of the competition gets their nation's flag risen and their national anthem played. The closing ceremony up until 1956 used to be similar to the opening ceremony, but a young boy in Melbourne, where the Olympics were, wrote to the Olympic Committee and said, you know, this Olympism, this idea, maybe at the end of the games, we should change it so that all the athletes come together. They come into the stadium together, no barriers, no boundaries, just everybody behind one Olympic flag. And this was a high school student in Melbourne. The Australian Olympic Committee, the organizing committee for the games, adopted the idea. And since then, that symbolism has been visible at every closing ceremony. So my question now is, well, if that's what it's all about, let's lose the nationalism of the medal ceremony. Let's when we award gold medals, let's raise the Olympic flag and play the Olympic anthem, so that the nation state isn't exalted, but the individual. Wow. Especially when the Olympic Committee is saying, oh, there should be no political demonstrations of any kind at the Olympics. Is not the medal ceremony with national flags, is that not the ultimate political symbolism?
Well, so now this is very interesting, because you mentioned the refugees marching behind the Olympic flag. That actually must have had took you back to the work you did with refugees at the World Service Authority Legal Department. Why don't you tell us a little more about that work and what you found in working with these refugees who are stateless?
Well, the first thing I learned was that the privileged life that I've been living, being able to participate in sport in the Olympics and not have to worry about persecution, that's there's millions of people on this world that are living tenuously because of their political situation or the situation on the ground in their country. And often those individuals, they have no recourse. They have no courts they can appeal to. They obviously can't appeal to their national governments. And the World Service Authority issues identity documents, including the world passport, to people that have nothing. And oftentimes it's never a guarantee, because of course world law is not established. There is, as of yet, no world court of human rights. Often just having something and having advocates on your behalf can make the difference, sometimes even between life and death, let alone of leaving a country and getting to a new one. So we had several of those cases, and it was very eye-opening work. And you know, again, it's like a public defender. You're helping someone out in a very specific situation, and you're a lifesaver, but you're not really changing the reality of the international apartheid system that exists, meaning the passport system. So ultimately you have to find a way to transcend that system so that there aren't refugees that can't travel freely on their planet. And of course, the World Service Authority bases almost all of its work in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, which, you know, just every nation in the world signed off on. And Gary Davis, of course, took that declaration and the articles in it and founded the World Service Authority to help advance human rights around the world. And if you know Gary's history, that was a mass popular and powerful movement, and it's ebbed and flowed since then. And that work is never going to be done until humans can travel freely and until we are one world and the nation state system is somehow transcended to some sort of world parliament or, you know, representative democracy or something.
I see you have a copy of that Universal Declaration of Human Rights behind you there on the wall. What is the difference for our listeners here between international law and world law?
International law is law that the nation states, it's a code that they agree to, but it doesn't take away the sovereignty of any one of the nations. So for example, if you think of the United Nations, there's almost 200 United Nations. There's actually more Olympic nations than United Nations, but they can promulgate regulations. Nations can make treaties. There can be multilateral treaties. But the way the United Nations set up is the most powerful nations, which form the Security Council, can essentially veto or ignore any element of international law and with legal impunity. Now, because there's no court to hold them accountable. So there may be political consequences or other economic consequences, but there's no legal consequences to a nation breaking a treaty or violating another nation's laws. So world law would hold all nations to the same standard and be accountable in a court of law, in a world court. In the case of human rights, it would be a world court of human rights. But getting nations, national governments, to cede their sovereignty for that new world is a challenge. And of course, that challenge has been written about by Einstein and many other people. Einstein himself viewed that as the ultimate solution, as did Emery, Reeve, and in Anatomy of Peace. I know, very influential for Gary Davis himself. That's where you got to go. And so, what can I do?
Yeah.
What can any of us do? We do what we can. We try to live the ideas. I always have my world passport. I've used it. I've like Gary. I've been detained because of it. But I've had it stamped. I actually have no other identity right now. No driver's license. Nothing. And I just had to travel, and that was my travel document. I wasn't crossing an imaginary national border, but it worked. And whether it's me or a refugee, sometimes that identity document can be crucial.
Now, that's interesting. That's your only identity document. And that, of course, has been so crucial for so many refugees. I know, even to get into the courthouse in DC to have their asylum hearing heard, people would need an identity document. So some of the immigration lawyers would send them over to the World Service Authority to at least get a world passport so they could get into court and get their case heard. Or, you know, Dave, there's a whole, David, I see, is on the call, and there's a whole separate podcast in which he talks about the many, many ways that this identity document has helped give people back their dignity and the crucialness of being able to have an identity and how you can't even get your kids in school or get medical care or anything else without an identity. So that's important work that you were doing there. Do you have an example when you were working there at the World Service Authority of a particularly moving case where you were able to help a stateless person and where it made a difference in their life?
Well, yeah, I think on a daily basis, any case we took, you're making a difference because someone who's completely lost and up against the world's national governments, knowing they had an advocate, someone in Washington, D.C. to answer the phone and advocate on their behalf, the dignity that could often confer and the hope that could generate is invaluable. Can't underestimate it. But I would say the case that moved me the most might be my own, actually. I went to the 2002, this was after meeting Gary Davis, I went to the 2002 Summer Olympic Games. I'm sorry, the 2004 Summer Olympic Games, which were in Athens, Greece. And I went with the intention of renouncing my U.S. citizenship. So I went there with a U.S. passport. I went there with my world passport. I actually got to Athens using only my world passport. And I went to the State Department, the U.S. consul in Athens, saying, hey, I'm here to take the oath of renunciation. And I'd learned about the process from Gary and Gary's books. And the consul there, the agent, was perplexed, confused. You know, here I was, a recent U.S. Olympic athlete, and he was like, "Well, where are you going to go? And I said, well, I'm going to go home. And he said, well, where's home? I said, Chicago. And he said, well, why would you renounce? And I talked about my ideals, no different than Gary's ideals. I felt like I'd rather not cooperate with the system of apartheid as I saw it, that was the cause of so many of these troubles. I'd rather just stand outside of it at my peril. And I knew the law as well. Gary and David Gallup, the president and head counsel, general counsel at the World Service Authority, had briefed me on the law, including the United States Immigration and Nationality Act. I had the relevant sections of the U.S. State Department manual. So I had all the legal answers, but the U.S. consul refused to allow me to renounce. He wouldn't issue a certificate of loss of nationality. And so I left the consul. I thought, well, what am I going to do? And I started talking with Gary and with David. And Gary said, look, Nathaniel, are you a world citizen? I said, of course I am. And he said, well, whether the U.S. government says you're a U.S. citizen or not, or doesn't issue an oath of renunciation, it doesn't change that fact. And as he knows well, I had limited resources. The government had endless resources. I knew I wanted to get back home eventually. So I ended up not being successful renouncing, but I came back from Greece. I got a plane eventually when the Olympics were over. I flew home, and right when I got to Dulles Airport, I had a decision to make, because you come off the plane and through customs, there's the U.S. national line, and then there's the foreigner line, the non-U.S. citizen line, and I had to figure out which line I was going to go through. So I went through the non-U.S. citizen line, and eventually I had a hearing in front of the little court they have there in the basement, and they asked me, you know, where's your passport? I showed them my world passport, and he said, that's not real. I said, of course it's real. You're holding it. I said, no, it's not valid. I said, well, I actually renounced while I was in Greece. And like, he said, well, where's your certificate? It's like your consul violated U.S. law and wouldn't give me one. And said, well, you're a U.S. citizen, buddy, because the government tells you what you are. And I said to the man, I said, well, then you're a British subject by that logic. And he was confused. I said, saying you're a U.S. citizen is a function of people that told the King of England they were no longer British subjects. What's the difference between that? That line of rhetoric didn't go well with him. He wasn't convinced, and he was getting annoyed to the point where he said, just throw this guy on the deck, which I gathered was INS speak for into the country. So he found my bags, he confirmed that I still had a U.S. passport in my checked luggage. And then he sent me away so that I wouldn't be causing any more trouble. So I don't know if legally I'm in the United States. I'm confused, but I am a world citizen. But the point of that story was it gave me some firsthand. It made the ideals behind Gary's work real. The harassment you can face, the difficulty of changing that system. But ultimately, you know, Gary's an educator as well, and every opportunity is a chance to educate.
Well, as an educator, when he gave up his citizenship, and we showed the newspaper clipping of that, he said it was an act of love for America, that this was the way to save America. And he saw, you know, that we really faced the possibility of doom from nuclear war. And of course, later he saw that from climate change too. And so, you know, some people think renounce means you don't like something, but he was saying, you know, I love you. That's why we've got to raise our citizenship. He was in many ways following in the footsteps of our founding fathers and mothers who said that, you know, they raised their citizenship above the nations that divided us, the states, Virginia and Maryland, to the United States. He says, let's take it to the next step. So in a way, he talks in the movie about world patriotism. And I think that's something you're promoting. Well, now it's interesting that you followed in that footsteps of Gary in that way. There's another thing that you did that was interesting that also was a parallel to Gary. Gary, of course, was an actor. And that's what he said gave him the courage to do all the incredible things he did in the world, because he saw the world as a stage, and he saw the cops in uniforms and rigid border guards. He saw those as sets. And he knew they wanted to play him to play into their game and, you know, be meek and mild and let them dominate. And he brought him into his game instead. He was a good actor and he could do good improv with him and bring them around. Well, tell me about how you, I know you've been in stage and film productions. How did your experience there tie in with your world citizenship or your life? I mean, what an amazing thing. Olympian, actor, lawyer. Tell us a little bit about that side.
Well, that can absolutely relate to Gary. And Gary is not just ability to improv, but his sense of humor and wit. That helped carry him through as well. But I was trained as an actor in undergraduate and spent a little time acting. I fell off the... I dropped off and ended up going to another Olympics and put a pause on my career. But I decided that I was going to use my talents and whatever charisma I had to act at the local level for change and try to live my life in accord with what I believe in justice and nonviolence to the best I could. And so everything I've done, I kind of very much view it as this is performance. This is performance art in a way. I taught a class called Alternatives to Violence, and our textbook was the movie The Matrix, which of course all the kids had seen, but the message there was the system of control more than anywhere else exists in one's own mind. And the mechanisms by which agents, whether that's government agents or whoever, the way controls are affected is through fear and confinement in your own mind. And so you have to transcend that and see that fear and arrest it and to live freely. And so, you know, we would study the movie, and of course it's entertainment, but you could tie it to these very global ideas. And so I'm always talking about the Matrix and, you know, does the Matrix have you? I'll tell my skaters or my students, and we would talk about it. And what does it mean to be free? Even if you're pursuing the goal of becoming an Olympic athlete, you have to conquer a lot of fears in your own mind. So there's that connection to Gary. But there's another connection, Arthur, which you probably didn't even know. One of my direct actions was I refused to do jury service in the District of Columbia. And I was in law school at the time. And I just didn't like the idea of being a mechanism for the injustice that I perceived was happening in the court, meaning the plea negotiations that were happening. And, you know, your average prosecutor is getting defendants to plead to something with the threat, well, hey, I can get a jury ready in just a second. So I'm going to refuse jury service. And that ended up landing me in DC Superior Court. And I heard the United States versus Nathaniel Mills, and my case was called. And I'll give you one guess, Arthur, who my judge was. It was the chief judge at the time of the DC Superior
Rufus
Court.
King.
Rufus King.
I didn't know it, but when you said give me a guess, I know he was also involved with Gary after a while. Well, not originally.
Played a key role with Gary. I had no idea who it was at the time. I didn't discover it until later, but looking back, I can tell why Gary and him got along, because he said, Mr. Mills, are you telling me that you'll always refuse jury service? Because that's a violation of DC law. And, you know, I can step you back right now. And, you know, that means lock you up. I said, Mr. King, Your Honor, I'm not saying what I'll do in the future. I'm just telling you that right now, my conscience has brought me to this moment. So I don't know what I'll do in the next moment, because it was a conscientious objection I was making. And he left the impression with me that he really appreciated the dialogue of it. I didn't even bring up world citizenship at the time, and I wished I had, but I had no idea of the connection. I didn't play that card. And so he said, well, Mr. Mills, I appreciate this position, but I'm gonna take your name and I'm gonna put it back in a jury pool, and we'll see next time your name comes up, we'll see what happens if I see you in my court again. And I never ended up in his court again. But I don't know, theoretically, Mr. King could have Judge King could have locked me up. But he found some compassion.
That's cool. Yes, Rufus King, actually his widow was one of the people who gave the first funds to get our movie started, The World Is My Country. And he became, I filmed him at the World Service Authority talking with Gary and David and so on. He became an advocate for world citizenship. And I don't know whether that was inspired by you or was before or after you, which one it was, but that's interesting.
Well, Arthur, if your dramatic film of Gary's life, I read the one screenplay as well. And if that dramatic film ever gets into production, at least since we're on camera and on the record, at least work it out so I can at least get let me at least read for Rufus King. Okay. That's I read that character in a resume. Just let me read for it. I'm not saying I got to get the part, but.
Well, the other day I was talking with Martin Sheen, you know, of course, who's been going on television promoting our film. He's going to actually be coming up on one of the major shows, the Tom Hartman Show, but he's been on MSNBC and other things promoting this wonderful movie, The World Is My Country. And he was so inspired by Gary's journey. Said he just read Gary Davis's book, My Country Is the World. And he said, wow, this should be a series, like a Netflix series. He said, every single chapter is an incredible adventure, and it would be a great ongoing series. Taking you all over the world, to all the top trouble spots we're seeing in the world today. So if you haven't read Gary's book, My Country Is the World, please do order a copy. You can get it from our website on the store part. You can get it from the World Service Authority. Or other places, but go ahead and read that book, because I'm glad I forgot that you've gotten to read my screenplay, but yes, I eventually do want to see if we can make this into a production where another actor plays this actor, and you can be the actor playing Rufus. So that's a fabulous idea.
Just give me a shot. I know. There's a production company. There's producers. Oh, there's casting agents. Yeah. But just give me a reading.
You've got the part. I'll tell them, you don't put him in that part, the movie doesn't get made. No, I think that'd be fantastic. But of course, we don't know if all that's going to happen or get funded. But it's great. Great that you share that vision.
Yeah, but you hit on a key. You know, when worldwide well-known celebrities like Martin Sheen or Leo DiCaprio, I know who knows of your work, when they start to get traction or start to believe in it, and they have, through their connections, try to get things made, then things can happen. And, you know, hearkening back to the conversation about the World Olympic team, you know, ultimately it may take some Olympic athletes who are well-known, who are willing to put themselves out there. You know, what does every Olympic athlete do when they win a race at the Olympics? What's in track and field? What's the first thing you see the athlete do after they win a race? It's almost cliche now. What do? They head to the stands and someone throws them their national flag. They're holding it up as, you know, the message is my country won or my ideology won. I don't know, but how about the athlete that might someday win a race and instead of grabbing their national flag, grabs the Olympic flag or even an earth flag, and makes a statement in front of, you know, global audience of millions of people that, you know, I'm a human first. It would take guts, I think, for one. It'd be a brave thing to do because there's backlash for you're unpatriotic. You didn't grab the national flag and, you know, world government, world citizenship. That's, you know, there's people that view that as a bad thing. So educating Olympic athletes, to start thinking about this early on. And I know my young athletes think about it from when they're 10 years old. But, you know, raising consciousness so that some brave athlete can feel emboldened to make those kind of a statement. And in fact, at the 2010 Olympics, where I was at the 2010 Olympics as an advocate with the United States Olympic team, David Gallup provided me with a whole bag full of I am a world citizen buttons, pins. And those quickly became the most popular pin in the Olympic Village. And you'd be watching interviews on television and they'd have the world citizen pin on their jacket. And, you know, the idea just resonated with the athletes because they're already doing something global. And I wish we'd have captured that more. And hopefully in Olympic games to come, we can get a little bit more of a movement and try to get more athletes to understand it's not just a pin, you know, there's something behind it as well, but, you know, it takes bravery and bold action, and there's consequence for for your action sometimes.
Thank you so much, Matt. And we'll come back at the end with a little close with you.
Yes, now we have time for questions. But first I want to say, Nathaniel, Coach Nat, I mean, your incredible commitment and your story of doing your own journey with giving up your national passport, and also the story of in 1956 of a young individual changing the Olympic ceremony was so powerful. I was just moved to tears. It was just beautiful. So that we can all do that. Just one individual like you, like Gary, like all of us. So thank you for that. Thank you for your commitment. I love it. It was beautiful, all of it. Okay, so yes, now we definitely want to go to David Gallup, president of the World Service Authority. And David, take it away, please.
Yeah, hey, thank you for having Nathaniel on today. I've been honored and privileged to work with Nathaniel over the past maybe 20 years, I guess it's been, even while he was separately working, teaching peace classes at local DC schools and getting to hear him speak. He's an amazing speaker. He comes and speaks to our student interns three times a year and talks to them about Olympism and the Olympic movement and how that relates to the work of World Service Authority. Plus, as our World Sports Commissioner, there's really a big untapped potential to bring, you know, so many people who love sports into the idea of world citizenship. And I can tell you that he's already started doing that. And here's a copy of the Sports Illustrated magazine, which is, hundreds of thousands of, readers. And there was an article about Nathaniel's protege or the person he taught, Shawnee Davis. And it's a fabulous article that promotes the idea of world citizenship in a mainstream publication. And, you can't really see that, but that's our world citizen button. Anyway, and the article actually mentions it because of Nathaniel actually at a press conference asking Shawnee about, well, Shawnee wore that on his backpack, that world citizen button.
After he won a gold medal, he was the gold medal Olympic champion in speed skating.
Right.
And then you go to the press conference right after you win.
And then Nathaniel says, Shawnee, how do you explain that you're a citizen of the world? You know, in front of all the media, in front of all the press, and just to boldly be able to ask that, Nathaniel, I think that's, incredible. And I think certainly you're the fact that, once again, like Gary, you are an actor as well as a lawyer. You put those two parts together to really advance this idea of world citizenship. So I guess my question for you, I've heard you talk about this so much that it's now in the back of my mind too, but how do you link the idea of sport and spirit and Olympism to maybe promoting world citizenship into the future?
The Olympics is an amazing platform to do that. It starts with education, right? I as an athlete, I was very nationalistic. I was, conditioned like every other person was. I envisioned, as I was training, I was envisioned the glory of, an Olympic medal and my national anthem playing, commercial endorsements that might become of that. No one had exposed me to bigger ideas. And, there's an opportunity to educate first. And because I have the credential of being an Olympic athlete, and a respected one in the United States anyway, I can communicate and speak, and I'll have a platform to this extent where the U.S. Olympic Committee actually asked my Olympism project to do some trainings with athletes and with staff people. And this was part of the conversation. We had conversations about nationalism and patriotism and the limits of those things with, in a boardroom with the Olympic Committee. And as Gary taught me so well, and as Gandhi said before him, you can disagree, but if you don't see eye to eye, you can still talk heart to heart. And I think it's the spirit with how you communicate that can make a big difference. And so that just having conversations within the Olympic movement has been the big thing. And now with social media, which wasn't around when I was competing, or even in the early days of this activism with the World Service Authority, it still wasn't an easy to connect with a lot of people, but now it's easier than ever. And for anyone that follows the Olympic movement, the athletes themselves are starting to you know, demand that, you know, you can't silence me and my platform. And the Olympic Committee has had to deal with this, and it's rules that prohibit any political statements. That's in the charter. No political statements of any kind, no demonstrations of any kind. And athletes are pushing back on that in ways great and small, more small than great, but it's a process. And I think if you continue to push it, you may get to the point where you can force the Olympic Committee's hand on nationalism itself, on like, look, your Olympic charter that you say everything is based on, the Olympic medal ceremony that exalts the nation state, it's antithetical to the principles of Olympism. What's with that? And maybe it's a critical mass of minds, and maybe some high profile minds that might start speaking about it, and change can happen. There's going to be incredible resistance, of course, but as everyone here knows, the Olympics are a you know, billion-dollar industry. It's a mega business model, and their sponsors and funding is global. You know, some of the largest multinational companies in the world fund the movement. But I think ultimately, anything that triumphs their brand, the rings and humanism, I think would be good for them. So, but it would take courage from the Olympic leadership to get to that point of, oh, here's some young man wrote that we should get rid of the national medal ceremonies and raise our own flag. That's going to take bold leadership from someone leading the Olympic Committee, because they're going to get pushed back. Every member of the Olympic Committee is still a national citizen of somewhere. And that nation state is proud that they're in that position of power. So I don't know. It's as Gary always said, it's from the bottom up. That's where the critical change has to happen. And the bottom, the base and the bottom's got to be, you know, got to raise its awareness. And if I can just use sport to help raise some awareness with the athletes in my world, that's what I'm doing or try to do.
Well, Nathaniel, I've got just a quick follow-up, because I know we've been working with Nonviolence International and what is it, PNND, to perhaps have a peace conference that's linked to the Olympics and the Paralympics, maybe in between those two events, because they usually happen one right after the other. Do you have any updates on that potential event, either for this summer or for the next Olympics?
No, we're still working on it. As you know, they weren't allowing all, you know, people from outside of Japan that weren't athletes to come and be spectators, but we're thinking of doing it virtually. But yeah, that idea originated around the idea of the Olympic truce, which, you know, in the ancient world, every 4 years, no matter what was going on in the ancient world, which city states were warring, you were granted safe passage to Olympia, Greece, where the ancient games were held. And for the fortnight of the Olympics, conflict was, I don't know if all conflict was stopped, but you were at least given the safe passage, safe travel. Across borders in many cases. And so the conversation now is, you know, every 4 years, the United Nations issues its declaration to honor the Olympic truce and to call on the nations of the world to suspend hostilities during the Olympics. And of course, it's toothless. And, you know, no nation that's warring or having military action, it's killing people, stops their killing during the Olympics. So this is an idea of, well, maybe we can you know, push back on that and try to get the Olympic Committee to hold its national participants more accountable, at least during the Olympics, maybe a day during the Olympics. During the 1994 Olympics in Lillehammer, Norway, the conflict in Bosnia, actually, they suspended hostilities for a day during the Olympics because of the truce. That a lot of people didn't think that would happen. It happened for a day, you know, to start. And the problem, of course, is that nations don't send athletes to the Olympics. National Olympic committees send delegations to the Olympics. So the nation state, the governments will say, oh, that's our Olympic committee. You know, they're not waging war. And those lines can blur. And in the United States, where I live, it's the National Olympic Committee that receives no funding from the national government. It's entirely individual and corporately funded. In China, you know, the Communist Party of China is synonymous with the Olympic Committee. It funds the Olympic Committee. So that government Olympic Committee line is harder to draw, but you'd think that would have to make the Chinese Olympic Committee more accountable. It's like piercing the corporate veil in law if you're trying to bring in a mass action. So there's challenges.
Thank you, Nathaniel.
Yes, thank you for that update. My goodness. And yes, we have a question we would like to go to Sjor.
I think this Olympic Games is the first time when a transgender person is allowed to compete. I think we don't have a problem with the different colors. We have solved the issue with the handicapped people. How do you deal, would you suggest to deal with this gender issue? Because as we learn from the queer movement, we have so many genders. Like, why do we try to put them in two boxes? And have you thought of any alternative?
Yeah, I've thought of a lot of alternatives. It's interesting because when an athlete, or at least when I was competing, when an athlete arrives to the Olympic Village, to the Olympic Games, from wherever they came from, the very first thing that's done is you report to the medical commission and they swab the inside of your mouth to learn your sex chromosomes, because your committee has enrolled you in either the male events or the female events, and they're testing for your sex chromosomes. Then, as you know, people aren't binary always that way, especially with their identity, but even with their chromosomes, it's not binary necessarily. And there's cases of athletes who don't fit neatly in one of those boxes. Castor Semenya is one of them. So she, you know, one solution is you can't exclude people from the events that are considered the men's events. And I know she's trying to qualify for the Olympic men's 5,000 meter event. That's happened in some other sports as well, in golf and tennis, where athletes have pushed that boundary. And then even in the Paralympic movement, there's been athletes that said, I don't just want to compete in the Paralympic Games. I want to compete in the Olympic 100 meter final at the main Olympic Games. And the Olympic Committee used to go and say, no, you can't do that. You're disabled. You have to be in the Paralympic Games. To, well, if you're fast enough to qualify, you should be able to qualify. But then, of course, many people say, well, that's an unfair advantage. You might have one leg, but you have a mechanism with a spring that can give you an unfair advantage. And that was a lot of athletes' response. And I know ultimately the Olympic Committee was forced to remove its barriers to allowing females, meaning two X sex chromosomes, to compete in the male events. And then they had to not ban Paralympic athletes from attempting to qualify in the main Olympic Games. But, you know, there's all kinds of other issues and other situations that's going to force their hand in. And I don't have any answers to this. I've heard people say there shouldn't be sex categories at the Olympics. Just have events. Just have events. And whatever, you know, the top performing event based on time or distance or whatever, just any human being can participate in that event. And then you have sub events for, you know, other categories of you know, like A level, B level, C level, and get rid of sex distinctions in sport. To the point where why can't males participate in the balance beam, for example, or rhythmic artistic gymnastics? So I think for me, the main thing is that this conversation is happening at the international IOC level and among the athletes and in the press, like it's never happened before. And, you know, it wasn't in my lifetime in 1984, that was the first time females were allowed to run a marathon. Up until 1984, it wasn't viewed that females could handle that event, that rigor. You know, they weren't allowed to swim past 800 meters because women can't do that. It was the male logic. And of course, males have dominated the Olympic Committee, European males at that. That's recent history. So I can't even imagine 30 years from now what boundaries will be pushed. Personally, my main focus has been on this nationalism piece. That's just my greatest interest in my education. But colleagues of mine are you know, advocating for the gender issues, the sex issues, the Paralympic issues. Paralympics right now, you say they've made great strides, but they will not allow Paralympic athletes to identify themselves as Olympians. They're Paralympians. They're separated. They're segregated. It happens afterwards. After all the viewers have watched. No, you're going to do it after, because it's not as important. And I don't have these answers, but, you know, it's a very dynamic time, even in the Olympic movement. And that's not even talking about the environmental impact and the critique of the Olympic Games of you know, this traveling circus where civil liberties are often undermined in the host nation to get ready to make all their money from the tourism and tear down buildings and put up new ones and give out fat contracts. Those are issues as well. There's cities, 30 years ago, a city that had gotten the support of its nation to bid for the Olympics, you couldn't imagine that a city, the people of a city would rise up and say, no, we don't want our city to bid. We don't want the tax consequence of this. We don't want the social injustice results that can happen. That's happened twice in the last 6 years in Boston and in Calgary, where the citizens said no. You know, people, a solution to that would be maybe you have Olympics at one location, the way the Olympic ancient games were. Everyone went to an Olympia, went to Olympia, Greece. And the infrastructure was built and set up to do it every year, instead of a new city and all the money that you got to raise and spend and who's getting rich, who's getting pushed out. The economic injustice and justice of the Olympics is a conversation as well, like never before.
The next question, do you buy the official 9/11 story?
Which story is that? There's a lot of stories.
Four airplanes, like 23 Arabs, stuff like that.
I've never drilled down on it one way or the other. Okay. My worldview is about cause and effect. And something that happens, the violence that happened on, violence did happen on 9/11, but the cause and effect of that it's never as simple as any government's explanation. And the roots of violence run well before that, including the United States government's own violence. I was taught violence in my school growing up. I was conditioned to believe in military solutions and the rightness of the military cause and just war theory. And then of course, as David Gallup can tell you, after 9/11, it impacted our work tremendously. The amount of passport issuance decreased as the travel restrictions went up. Our work's been much harder, predictably. And now during COVID, I would say the same thing has been happening. It's made our work difficult in some ways, but also an opportunity in others. And of course, I started teaching nonviolence right in the wake of 9/11. And as tragic as that day was for so many people, it was a wonderful opportunity to start having discussions about solutions to violence, whether that violence is the government's violence, corporate violence, personal violence, legal violence, economic violence, because everything's tied together. And the narrative that you're taught as a national subject, and I know this as a U.S. being in the United States, it's the official explanation is always just that. It's the official version, and it's very calculated to push a narrative and an agenda.
Nathaniel, you are an incredible speaker, and you're so informative, and you're such a rich, rich talk, and we so appreciate it. And now we are going back to Arthur. Arthur, take it away.
Well, I want to thank you so much. You know, I want to just make one comment that, as you mentioned, the shifts happening over gender issues, you know, we've seen such momentous shifts happening as we see a rise of the spirit of the people, where, you know, the old barriers that all used to have to be run by, you know, rich white men have been breaking down, and we're seeing diversity of colors, of people, of genders, and all these boundaries breaking down. But the one that hasn't yet broken down is, as you mentioned, nationalism. Even though we are, you know, open to all people, all cultures, we're not, and then we go ahead, but okay, but you're outside the country, so we can kill you, we can torture you, whatever. And I think the key is what you said. I think that's the next big shift that has to happen if humanity is to survive, is we do have to begin to identify ourselves as world citizens. And so I'm so thrilled that you've taken the path you have and to have you working on this with us. And so I want to say this has been a very special opportunity to hear more about you and your work. I want to thank you immensely. I also want to say to people that if you want to identify yourself as a world citizen, if you do go to theworldismycountry.com, you'll both see in the store where you can buy t-shirts like this and so on. But you'll also see on the passport tab at the top a link to take you over to David's page at the World Service Authority. And you'll see how you can start the process of applying for a world passport And you can also now do it online. It's so crucial because it really is a sense, something you can feel and sense and hold and identify yourself with humanity as a whole. And I like that you said, Gary used to say, you know, if he went to a border guard and they said to him, oh, we don't recognize that, Gary would say, but I do. You know, and that's the ultimate authority. I mean, Gary said, you know, all every constitution, the universal declaration says it's the right of the people to institute a government. He said, why are we knocking our heads against the wall trying to convince these guys who are part of this broken nation state system to fix things? We've got to take our responsibility as world citizens to rise to the top and do it. And he took the first step, and I hope he inspires us all. So thank you for being part of this inspiration. I do like your idea of seeing you eventually in the movie with an ongoing TV series, which is even better because there's so much in Gary's life that we couldn't fit in this movie. You know, this movie is just the tip of the iceberg. When you read his book, My Country is the World, you'll see that there's adventure after adventure after adventure. So do that. Come to our same store where you can get the t-shirts, you can get the book, and also go over to David's link. He has them available there as well. Well, I want to thank everybody. I see Jack's holding up a picture he wants to show people a second. Do you want to say something for a minute, Jack, about what you're showing us?
Yes, that's we're building a People's Light Beacon of Hope Peace Tower, and that will help in any given community to take vulnerable people that feel homeless, feel hungry, feel abused, feel depressed, feel hopeless, feel suicidal, direct them to resources, but give them meditations of hope as well. And I believe that something like that, if someone held up after winning a medal and said, I want to honor the people's light, not necessarily the Olympic torch, okay? Because the people's light stands for everybody. And I think that, wouldn't it be interesting, Arthur, if all Rotarians who are in 200 countries doing good by doing what's the truth, what's fair, what builds goodwill, and what's beneficial to all concerned, what if 1.2 million Rotarians became global citizens? That would sign that we are one humanity, and people, and they represent a lot of different people and countries. So this idea, I don't know. Thank you for what you do.
Well, one of the first you know, at the very beginning of our film that played on television stations across the country is a salute to Rotary that Rotarians helped fund to help sponsor that. But now we haven't moved to the next step, but we really need a committee of Rotarians to help us get this movie seen by Rotarians everywhere, because that would be the first step. It certainly inspired Sheikh Armetta, who is the incoming president of Rotary International. And if we can inspire people with that vision through the movie as a first step, we'd love to have your help and others in doing that and get that, get this concept of world citizenship out, because it's a natural for Rotary. They've always worked beyond the borders that divide us, and never has Rotary just been confined to one country. So anyway, I want to thank you. And I also want to go back to Nat to ask, how can people find out more about your work? How can they engage with you? Can they sign up to be a part of any of the things you're doing? Tell us a little bit more about that, and then please give us your closing comments.
Well, you can't really keep up with me unless you're following me around on the ground. the Olympism Project website, we're on social media at Olympism Project, trying to get as many athletes as we can, both competing, past competing, and up and coming to follow that, so we can continue the conversation at least online. And then during the games, of course, if we have a virtual workshop, we invite you to that. But most importantly, if you've been stimulated by the conversation today, just carry these conversations on in your own life during the Olympics with people around you. And often it's just a matter of asking questions. That's the start, you know, talk about ideas that people have not talked about before. And you never know, things can change that way.
Well, in mentioning Rotarians, you should get Nat as a speaker at Rotary Clubs. All right. Well, this has been phenomenal. I think a lot of people would be moved to hear that. I wish you could get your voice out much more widely. We also have a special event coming up. We are going to have the film shown, the full version, I believe, the 83-minute version is going to be shown at World Unity Week. And Rotarians are very involved in helping to put this on. I know a number of Rotarians like David Wick have been working very hard on this with others. Thank you for joining us in another episode of the People Powered Planet Podcast.
World citizen, lift up your voices. Oh, you know we got something to say. All we need is the same directions, heading in one way.
Thank you for watching. Please subscribe to our channel and like this video.